Holics Network 18, Mission Poshan, Bhavishya Roshan.
Tracking this evening, today the Allahabad High Court directed the Finance Secretary of India to hold a meeting with power producers in June to see if a solution for troubled power companies is possible. The High Court directed that action against power companies may be avoided till this meeting takes place, provided, of course, the company is not a willful defaulter. Remember, earlier this year, a parliamentary panel report on non-performing assets in the power sector expressed concerns over the quantum of bad loans in this sector. The report had highlighted that banks had not been prudent while considering loans for power projects. We also reached out to Ashok Khurana, Director General of Association of Power Producers. He said that the Allahabad High Court ruling has put a question mark on RBI's Feb 12th circular.
See, let me clarify. It's basically a preliminary order which directs Secretary of Finance to hold a meeting in the month of June and taking consideration the views of the power producers and especially the 37th report of Standing Committee on Energy, which was presented in March 2018.
Okay.
Because if you recall, the Standing Committee on Energy had called RBI, bankers, Ministry of Power, Ministry of Finance, CEA, regulators, and private developers. And after hearing all parties, they had made observation, and their main recommendation was that all that we have mess in the power sector is because of the structure of the sector and the policy and the regulatory issues. So their observation, which is very clear, to quote from there, and simply applying the RBI guidelines mechanically by the banks, financial institutions, joint lender forums, will push these plants further into trouble without any hope of recovery. They had recommended at that time that a task force should be set up with the bankers, judicial people, power sector experts, who will go through all this and suggest a way forward or a line of action.
Okay.
Now, that is what I think has prevailed upon the High Court in asking the Finance Secretary to take a meeting, hear all this, and they have actually quoted the report of the Energy Standing Committee on Energy.
You mean that means the circular is not stayed, but there is no coercive action? By that you mean that come September 1st, if there is no resolution, they cannot be taken to NCLT. Is that how we should understand it?
My dear, in case, the High Court clearly says that hence the following order, and that is asking for a meeting to be done. So that part is completely left silent. So basically what RBI may be looking at is the High Court. The Finance Secretary will have a meeting and send the report to the High Court.
Okay, so in that case, the RBI circular's impact goes on unharmed?
See, my idea is it has put a question mark on the RBI circular.
Okay.
So the actually court, without actually staying in word, has stayed in substance.
Okay.
The High Court has heard and therefore they found merit that this circular should not be applied and the recommendations made by the parliamentary panel should be taken on account.
Well, we'll take that story forward and Lata Venkatesh is here with us. Lata, you know, what is the significance of this High Court order and how much of a relief will this really bring for stressed power companies?
Well, first, the scope of the order itself. The circular has been held in abeyance only for power companies and only till the next meeting. And that meeting has been ordered by the court to be fixed in June. It should be called by the Finance Ministry and should be attended by RBI officials, bankers, and several other respondents, maybe power and coal ministries as well. Other areas, the circular remains unaffected. And it's very unclear what happens after the meeting. Everyone knows that the power sector problems are run very deep. For instance, what can this meeting of the various ministries do about the lack of power purchasers or power purchase agreements. The power purchase agreements are not in place because the DISCOMs are cashless, so to speak, are impoverished, are running losses. What can an interministerial meeting do about something which is in the jurisdiction of state governments? What can it do at all in an election year? So it is unclear how quickly and how effectively this rather deep problem can be resolved. And if it is not resolved after the meeting, what is the effectiveness of the circular? It does look like it is going to be extremely difficult for the Reserve Bank to order the banks to take these companies to the NCLT with the court watching and this order already in place. But there is no clarity. The court has not told RBI or the banks not to take them to the NCLT at all. They've only directed that nothing be done till the meeting takes place. So much hinges on the meeting. And thereafter, the court will also hear the petition on whether it is maintainable or not. What Reserve Bank is arguing would be, I would assume, that this is a policy matter and the court should not even be getting into it. So then they, you know, the arguments will veer over to that. So it's a little, it's slightly uncertain at this point in time. If at all it's a relief, it's a temporary relief because everyone is expecting that the meeting will bring some policy measures to alleviate the pain of the power sector. No comments till that meeting happens.
All right, so we'll wait for the outcome of that crucial meeting on which the power sector's future hinges. Lata, thank you very much for joining it. But moving on, farmers' unions across 8 states have launched a mega 10-day protest against the government's failure to deliver on promises made to farmers. The protests are being held under the banner of the Rashtriya Kisan Mahasangh, a federation of 130 farmer organizations. The farmers have suspended the supply of vegetables and dairy products and will also stage roadside dharnas along 30 major highways in the country. Rohit Kaur is covering the protests in Ludhiana and joins us now. Rohit, what are the farmers' demand and what is the situation on the ground?
जी बिल्कुल, मैं आपको बताना चाहूँगा कि आज जो फार्मर्स ने सुबह से ही इस प्रोटेस्ट को करना शुरू कर दिया था और जो पंजाब की जितनी भी सब्ज़ी मंडी है उनके बाहर उन्होंने कई जगह पर अपनी जो ट्रैक्टर्स वगैरह रहते हैं उनको ब्लॉक करके उनको मंडियों को ब्लॉक कर दिया था कि किसी भी तरीके से कोई भी शख्स अपनी सब्ज़ी ना बेच सके, क्योंकि सब्ज़ी मंडी में जो सब्ज़ी ऑलरेडी पड़ी हुई थी उस चीज़ को जो दुकानदार थे, व्यापारी थे, वो बेच रहे थे, उसका भी उन्होंने विरोध किया है। मैं इस समय लुधियाना की सबसे बड़ी पंजाब की ये सब्ज़ी मंडी है, मैं आपको इसका दृश्य दिखाना चाहूँगा कि इस सब्ज़ी मंडी में अमूमन सब्ज़ी बहुत बड़ी तादाद में यहाँ पर आती है, पर आज के दिन में आप देख सकते हैं कि बहुत बहुत कम रेशो में यहाँ पर सब्ज़ी देखने को मिल पा रही है। और इसका सीधा सीधा जो ये जो असर है, ये सीधा सीधा वही किसानों के जो आंदोलन का असर है जो देखने को मिल रहा है। किसानों ने यही नहीं, सिर्फ सब्जियां ही नहीं बंद करी हैं, यहाँ तक कि दूध की सप्लाई भी बंद कर दी है, क्योंकि एक बड़ा तबका दूध की सप्लाई गांवों से शहरों को करता है, तो इस चीज़ को लेकर जो दूध की सप्लाई है वो भी उन्होंने बंद कर दिया। यहाँ तक कि जो अगर कोई दूध वाला अपना दूध देने के लिए शहर की तरफ आ रहा था तो उनके दूध को भी सड़कों पर फेंका गया है। मेरे साथ यहाँ पर कुछ एक लोग मौजूद हैं जो व्यापारी हैं, सब्ज़ी मंडी के हैं, जो पिछले काफ़ी लंबे समय से सब्ज़ी का काम कर रहे हैं। उनसे बात करेंगे, उनसे पूछेंगे कि इस जो आज आंदोलन शुरू हुआ है किसानों का, इससे इनके व्यापार पे कितना फ़र्क पड़ा। सर, क्या कहना चाहेंगे जो आज सब्ज़ी मंडी में किसानों ने अपनी सप्लाई बंद कर दी है और अगले 10 दिन तक वो कह रहे हैं कि हम सप्लाई नहीं देंगे, तो इसका असर कितना पड़ता हुआ दिख रहा है?
बहुत ज़्यादा असर पड़ रहा है जी। आज तो पहला दिन है, जैसे किसानों का आंदोलन जो शुरू हुआ है, आज तो पहले दिन में जो 100% जो सब्ज़ी आती थी, ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा एवरेज लगाएं तो 25% 30% से ज़्यादा सब्ज़ी नहीं आई। कुछ एक तो कल की बची थी वो बिकी है, बाकी रेट का जो है टोटल मिला के डबल हो गया, एक दिन में ही फ़र्क पड़ा। तो आप अंदाज़ा लगा सकते हो कि आने वाले समय में अगर ज़्यादा लंबी खिंच गई ये स्ट्राइक तो बहुत ज़्यादा है, क्योंकि जो लुधियाना सिटी है कम से कम 60-65 सीट लोकल जो एरिए पड़ते हैं, गांव पड़ते हैं छोटे जो, और इसके साथ मैं कहना चाहते होटल रेस्टोरेंट हर एक तबके को बहुत ही ज़्यादा फ़र्क पड़ने वाला है, जैसे आने वाले अगर ये खिंच जाती है तो। होगा।
बिल्कुल बिल्कुल, आप देख सकते हैं कहीं ना कहीं इन्होंने साफ कह रहा है कि अगर 10 दिन तक ये स्ट्राइक चलती है, किसानों का ये आंदोलन चलता है, तो इसका बड़ा असर हर वर्ग के ऊपर पड़ेगा।
GST revenue collections for the month of May have come in at over 94,000 crore rupees, but much lower than the 1 lakh crore rupees that was collected in April. However, the government argues that the numbers are higher than the average monthly average GST collection of over 89,800 crore rupees in the last financial year. Timzy Jeporia joins us with further analysis of these numbers. Timzy, it is a bit of a slowdown in the May collections, but that's not worrying the government yet.
Well, as you rightly said, it's not worrying the government because government was expecting these numbers. The numbers that have come in, that is 94,000 odd crore rupees, which is the total GST revenue collections for the month of April recorded in the month of May, is on the expected lines. Not just this, let me run across to the breakup first. CGST is about 15,800 odd crore rupees, SGST around 21,000 odd crore rupees, IGST a combination of IGST from imports at 49,000 odd crore rupees and assess at 7,300 odd crore rupees. Now remember, when you talk of the overall returns, the returns are a bit higher. That is 62.4 lakh returns have been filed for the month of April in the month of May. Now this is this was in the earlier month around 60 lakh figure. So that means the as compliance has improved, as e-way bill has rolled out, government feels that more compliance coming in, more and more people filing their returns would actually help them achieve the monthly average of 1 lakh 10,000 odd crore rupees. But yes, as of today, these numbers are falling short of the monthly average which government has budgeted for the current fiscal. Overall, government is gung-ho. They say they've already said that these numbers are just what we have seen and would be only in the first few months of the fiscal. So let's see, let's wait and watch what actually happens when the collections for other months come in.
In the past week, two big cases have crept up of auditors resigning from their duties due to insufficient information about the financial accounts of these companies. Deloitte resigned from Manpasand, while PwC resigned from Atlanta. Prashant Nair has the detailed analysis. Prashant, what's bothering these auditors? Why so many resignations?
It might seem like with the flurry of resignation that auditors have tendered that it's actually a very routine practice, but actually it is not. I mean, if you go back in history, resigning from an audit assignment actually is a pretty extreme step. And the simple reason for that is, especially in listed companies, it's an extreme step because, auditors also have a responsibility to shareholders because shareholders appoint auditors. I mean, the board appoints auditors approved by the shareholders. It's not as if, the promoter of the company or the CEO by himself or herself appoints the auditor. So when an auditor resigns, people sit up and take notice and say, well, what's going on? What could be the reason we are seeing this flurry of auditor resignations? Is it just, a couple of things happening together, bunched up, and, hence it's seeming like there is a pattern to it? Well, there are a couple of valid reasons why this could be happening. The first is, who governs the auditing profession, actually has changed. Now, the authority which is going to govern this is called the NFRA, which is the National Financial Reporting Authority. It was set up by the Government of India. It's going to have a chairperson, three full-time members and a secretary. And this authority will essentially have all the powers and more, which was earlier vested with the ICAI. They can penalize, they can bar auditors, they can fine. And of course, with the spate of banking scams we've seen and the action which we've seen coming in from investigative agencies like the SFIO and the CBI, I think auditors are being especially wary and careful at this point in time. The other issue is rotation of auditors. Now, this works both ways. Under the company's law, what basically is now happening is a company can have an auditor for a period of 10 years, two terms. Then you have to have a cooling off period of 5 years, and then that auditor can be reappointed later. So, there is this question up in the air. Are auditors being extra careful? Is it playing on their mind that, okay, let me be very clear about what I'm doing, because very soon there is going to be another person who's going to come on board. Before this rotation was introduced, we had auditor corporate relationships, continuing for, in some cases, decades. Same auditor continuing year after year after year. So that is the other thing. The other side of rotation of auditors is that maybe it's a good thing, right? Auditors are up on their feet and they are being extra cautious. So that is the other issue. Investors, of course, are being left high and dry. Look at the damage in stock prices, right? I mean, we've had Manpasand down 50%, Atlanta down 32%, Vakranji down about 93%. I mean, of course, the demise of Vakranji started way before auditors stepped in and sort of resigned from their audit assignment. It happened in April. Well, what are the reasons which auditors are giving for quitting? It's mostly information not being provided. That is true in Manpasand, in the case of Atlanta. Again, significant information not provided in the case of Vakranji. There was a bit more detail, but again, I mean, the main contention from the auditor was that management responses were inadequate. All this gets us to the question, what do investors do? So here are some of the sort of answers which investors and our viewers are seeking as well. Should auditors give more reasons for resigning from an audit? I mean, you know, people cite confidentiality, but confidentiality is between the board which appoints the auditor and the auditor. The auditor can tell the board very clearly what the issue is. They can't disclose it to a third person, so why aren't auditors saying more when they give up an audit? Why not specify exact reason for leaving? And of course, when the big four and most large auditing firms take up an assignment, they do a full KYC. They sit down with the management, they go through the book of accounts, they look at who signed off on the accounts last year, and then they take up the assignment. So, I mean, you know, are the KYC and the checks and balances rigorous enough for them to resign? I mean, in the cases of two out of the three that I mentioned, the auditor was appointed the same very year that they actually quit their assignment. Back to you.
All right, Prashant, thank you very much for that detailed analysis there. But with that, it's a wrap on this edition of After the Bell. Stay tuned to CNBC TV18. Taking Stock is up next, where we will take stock of all the market action in the week gone by.